We're here at Durango Public Library. Today is April 25th, I believe. We're here for the Durango Police Department Town Hall meeting. Let's see what they have to say. Hello. How's it going?
Pretty good. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, thanks.
It's a cool tool you got.
Hey, you like that?
Oh, are you filming?
I am. This is an iPhone. And this is a body camera.
Okay. Are you looking for the town hall meeting?
I am.
Right back in the room.
Right on. Should be starting shortly here. I'm doing well.
Oh, there's the man.
How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
Good. Welcome.
Thanks.
Yeah. Where do I get a hat like that?
Long Island audit. How's it going, Bryce?
Good. How are you, bud?
Yeah, well, how are you?
Good. Real good.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Now we're snowing because we have mountain dog poop. We're snowing and our dog would poop in the same spot and it snows more and built up to be about 7
telling you to get out?
Yeah. Saying I have a few seconds left.
You're between Casey and Bryce.
I thought I'd be right here.
You're right here.
Welcome to leadership.
You get to answer all of Adam's questions, Kathleen.
Oh, okay.
I'm just kidding.
How are you doing?
Good.
So
you got kids?
I don't. Single.
That's why your hair's not gray.
Yeah, exactly. Otherwise, I have to go take care of kids and cook some dinner for the family, you know? I don't, yeah.
You got a daughter's first year of college. She's learning gratitude now, which is nice.
Well, this is a
16-year-old son.
This is a
awesome. The whole world loves her.
Right? Teen- yeah. Are they out of the house yet?
I just got one, and then he's coming back to visit this summer. He's in college, and then I've got a 13-year-old and a 16-year-old.
Uh huh. Okay. Hey, I know you guys.
Hello.
I haven't seen you in a long time.
Sweetie.
How are you?
I am very well. It's so good to see
good
everybody.
To see you.
Yes.
Thanks for having me.
What's up, Tom?
I was coming down here to Helena, but what's it called? The Police Academy? What's it called? The Citizens Academy?
Oh, right.
Oh, you guys were?
What's that?
How are you, Tom?
Good. No, I was just going to come by you.
Well, you know, you need to give him a hard time.
I just got to meet him and see you. Last time I did that, we tried.
It's awful.
It's because he's poaching.
He's learning. Yeah, I've been learning from him. No, I'm just going to see what's going on.
How are you?
I'm well, thank you. I'm kind of like just
hello, sweetie.
How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I'm good.
Sweetie?
Yes. Just enjoying life.
Right
so
on.
Good to see you.
Hey, likewise.
Mm-hmm. I've got the same mountain bike. She uses a different
yeah. Heck yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. 5'10s is the best.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love flats. Clips. Might be it for this evening, so we want to keep everybody as we cross our fingers and hope that other people are going to show up. Thank you for coming tonight. My name's Bob Rammer. I'm Chief of Police with City Durango. I think I know everybody here, which is fortunate. So that introduction is kind of new. But thank you very much. We haven't had a town hall meeting probably about 4 years. And obviously we had this big pandemic and everything else that came through, and it kind of derailed a lot of our personal engagements we had opportunities for. But we wanted to re-engage and get back into this again so we can open it up for dialogue and have our forum. So just I'd like to introduce a few people. We'll just start out with Jake.
I'm Jake Dunlop. I'm the administrative division commander for the police department, handling most of the administrative functions, training, recruiting, hiring, records, property, evidence, stuff like that.
Thanks, sir. Thank you.
My name is Casey Malone. I'm one of the commanders at the police department. I'm over half of patrol, detectives, SWAT, traffic, miscellaneous other things. So I'm a new guy. I've only been with the agency almost a year. Prior to joining the Durango Police Department, I spent just shy of 20 at the Farmington Police Department. I was able to retire down there. So I've been in the business for a while, but I'm new here. So glad to be here.
Thank you. Captain's role tonight too. She's here. She speaks Spanish very, very proficiently. So she's here just in case we have any language barriers and we're going to move into the breach.
Nice.
Bryce.
Hi there. My name is Bryce Curran, and I retired from San Juan County, New Mexico, for just shy of 20 years, just like Casey. I've been here 3 years. Love this community. Glad to be here. Love to work for Chief Bremer. That's who I used to partner. Directly where our authority comes from, and we part of the reason we're here today, we like to communicate with the community and hear from the community as well, and also gain personal relationships with individuals in the community. Thanks. Glad to be here.
I'm Ray Shoup. I'm a commander on the other side of the operations house, so everything that Casey doesn't want to do, I get to do. So I'm over half a patrol and community programs, SROs, PSTs, their public service technicians, things like that. This November will be 25 years for me at the police department. Prior to that, I had done 4 years in different sheriff's offices and then decided that I didn't want to go through another election, so I came over to the PD and been here ever since. So.
In the back of the room, we have Amy Lemons. She's one of our administrative assistants at the police department. She'll be taking notes this evening. So if we do have questions, we're not going to try to use the microphones unless anybody wants to. But other than that, we'll just try to keep it just awesome in dialogue. And just hopefully she'll be able to hear us and try to repeat the questions so that she can. So just let us know, Amy, if you miss anything, and we'll get it repeated. All right, one other housekeeping item we want to talk about. We got cookies back there, we have water, so please feel free to grab any refreshments. We have a lot of them. If you want to take a bit of those, we're
they're delicious.
Outstanding, thank you. Also what we're gonna do tonight is we have 3x5 note cards. So if you don't feel comfortable asking a particular question or anything, you know, just write it on there and we'll get back to you. Just give us your contact information so we can address it back to you. That's probably going to be a problem because we have a pretty small group this evening, so if we'll be able to answer any questions that you may have. But there also may be something that maybe we don't know and maybe we want to get back to you on if there's an opportunity for us to do a little bit of research or do a little bit of digging or inquiries through other areas we might need to get there.
And also, if you think of something later, we're always available. I mean, I've spoken to several people in here, Adams comes by, and we are accessible all the time.
And I'm not gonna sit down. I sit down all day, and so I like moving. So I'll probably stand up because he's back. You know. So. Anyways, the purpose of this town hall forum that we're hosting this evening is really just an open dialogue. We don't have an agenda. We're hoping that the conversation will drive itself. And if there's any questions, any concerns, any comments, any direction, anything that you want to engage or inquire of the police department, that's what we're here for. So we've got all of our experts up here, and you know, if we don't have the answers, we'll certainly find it. But I really thank you for all for taking time out of your evening and coming out. So, and unfortunately, I know everybody. I'm not sure I haven't met you before. Okay, where have I met you before?
You met me on the street.
Okay.
I live on Junction Street, and I talked to you about speeding.
Yeah, okay, absolutely. Okay.
Which I might mention tonight.
Conversations, I got my traffic out here. So.
Is Officer Wysocki here?
He's not here this evening, but he reports to Officer Malone.
What is your name?
Commander Malone.
Casey Malone.
How do you do?
What was your first name?
Robin.
Robin.
And I don't mean to jump in and bring it up now, but I just want to thank you all for being here. I came very disheveled because I thought there's no way I'm going to wait in line. I'm going to be at the back of a crowded room. I probably won't even get to say anything. I'm in my pink clothes. I almost feel like crying. I don't know why this room isn't packed, but I want to thank you all so sincerely for coming here. I really appreciate it.
Thank
it's
you.
It's the first one I've ever heard of.
Yeah. Well, like I said, we haven't had one for a long time.
Oh. Okay.
You know, and it's because of COVID and everything, but this is something we plan on two of these this year, along with some neighborhood groups as well throughout the next couple months. So please feel free to come and attend those as well, and we'll continue to advertise it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm embarrassed.
You shouldn't be.
Don't
be. Well, this is something to build from, right? We've got to start somewhere. And then after that, we can build up.
Okay.
Well, I had a comment. A few years ago, we had a community police group that would go downtown.
A community engagement.
That's the right word. And I really appreciated that. I worked downtown at night, and I saw two policemen on the street walking. And I went, oh, yes, maybe it's coming back. Is it coming back, sir?
This is a big hope. So the question is will community engagement be back? So we have in our strategic plan, we actually put it in our plan last year, but we couldn't meet our staffing challenges to get to that point. So we made it another strategic item for 2022, and we hope to be able to engage that. But right now we have four vacancies within the department, and we have three anticipated departures. So until we can get to that level, and then the city managers basically green-lighted us to go ahead and hire past that amount, once we achieve that number, we'll identify that those people are to get it. Because we know the value of it. Every one of us who worked at the police department for the last couple of years saw that, our officers saw that, our community members saw that, and we know that's a value. But right now, we just can't continue to rob from our patrol division because we're barely keeping up on our response to calls, and those are the things we can't control. So, we're trying.
Thank you.
So if you know anybody who wants to be a police officer, Mayor, please let us know. Yes.
I live on Junction Street. I call it Junction Street Speedway. I really am going to buy some of those black and white check flags. I don't care how much it costs, and put them outside like it's a racetrack. That's what it's become. I live on the curb, and nobody wants to patrol that because it's so close to the county line. I had an experience about a month ago where I came home just at dusk, and a little trio of deer were crossing on the curb, and I described what happened, and on Nextdoor, if you all know what that social media thing is, and the last time I looked, 98 people had commented, speeding's huge on Nextdoor, but it's really disturbing on Junction Creek Street because there are two places where wild animals cross. It's on that curb that's a blind curb. It's once the bicycle path was put in, it just opened it up. People start gunning at about the nursing home, and by the time they get past my house to hit the curb, literally 45 miles an hour, that is the average speed in a 25. They're really aggressive. If my neighbors and I put up signs saying, please slow down, drive like your kids here. I've had people drive up on my property and bend the T-post trellised and run over it with their big truck tires. They, you know, I'm the crazy speeding lady in the front of my house, and they'll flip me off or they'll purposely speed up when I see a police logo. If I'm out taking my garbage or something, they're very aggressive and entitled. And I call a lot, they bring out the trailer. I'm told from you all that the trailer does something, but I don't know what it does. Many years ago, I asked Sweetie, and she said get speed bumps, but now they're no longer allowed. You don't have patrolmen. I don't know what to do, but it's getting more and more out of hand, and as summer comes, it'll be even worse. And there's a huge traffic that goes out in trucks, and you know, nobody pays attention to the sign. We need signage, we need stop signs, we need pedestrians. There's two corridors where people are stopping to go up Burkitt Open Space Trail and Dalla Right. I'm in between those two. So I feel like we could change something on the street to slow people down, a stop sign, a crosswalk. Do you ever consider buying one of those high-tech cameras that could keep track of people?
So we've got a couple options. I know Casey's got a chopper and get some guns up. We do have the speed trailers, and speed trailers sometimes get false surveys because people see them. So you either speed up or slow down based on what that is, so it can be deterrence or it could be an enhancer, right? So recently, they've invested in these covert ones that do the speed studies. They're really accurate because no one knows that they're there. And so we can really determine the times of day so we can put those enforcement efforts out there.
What did you call it?
It's a speed box. And so it's a covert one, so
covert,
you can't see it. You don't necessarily know it's there. It just looks like another piece of utility that's going to be on a pole or something to that effect. But once we determine those particular times, then we have two traffic officers, so our traffic division is full. And you know, we can deploy those out there at those times. And I know we've been doing blitzes out there. We'll go out there and we'll hit the hard and heavy, but then we'll have another problem somewhere else. So it's always that kind of that moving target, so to speak, because we have to go all the different places. In some of the areas that we work have high crash ratios so that takes precedence or something that's just a speed related type thing. But I know Casey's working on several different speed initiatives in the strategic plan just this year, so I'm gonna turn it over to him to kind of let you know, give some foresight on what that's gonna look like.
So I guess to start it off, not to get too off into it, because I can talk about traffic, it excites me.
I can too.
So basically,
I have videos.
We responded to two different speeding complaints or traffic complaints based on two pieces of criteria. Crashes with injuries is the first one, and complaints is the other. So when people complain of issues, oftentimes we'll put the covert box up there and see if we can support putting manpower out there. So as it relates to any traffic problem anywhere, there's three ways to address it: engineering, education, and enforcement. Okay? Engineering is not what we do. I have a brother that's an engineer, and he makes a lot more money than I do. So he's a lot smarter than I am, I guess is what I'm getting at. But education and enforcement are ours. And so often they go hand in hand. So we can, you know, what you're doing on Nextdoor is education. Same stuff that we try to do on social media, on Facebook and stuff like that, saying we're gonna have traffic officers out in these areas and enforcing these type of violations for this reason. We're telling the community this is where we're gonna be and this is what we're gonna be here for. That's an education component. Then we support that, we back it up by putting the officers out there and stopping vehicles and writing citations. And when we write citations, we tell the public, hey, we're here in this area right, these type of like violations because of crashes or because of complaints or whatever, and we support that education component with the enforcement. So I say all that to say this, we will absolutely deploy some of our covert speed boxes out there in that area, and if the data supports it, we'll deploy resources out there shortly.
Well, I appreciate that. Would you be able to
Yeah, that's the coolest thing about these boxes is they're we can do that in different places, and with the trailer we couldn't. And that's always been the problem with how they redesigned Junction Street, was when they put the bike lanes in for a long time, the old last one. So, you know, it's hard to do enforcement out there because we can't put like a motorcycle or a cop there or park the trailer in a particular spot because of the way the lanes are. So these boxes, we can pretty much, if there's a pole, we can stick on there.
Yes. And that was another component that he hit on there that, and I'm not completely familiar with the curb that you're talking about on Junction Street. I'll get out there and look at it. But
you're at the very end, almost at the end of the city limits, right? As it comes around. So you're on the curb where the county starts.
Yeah. Well, I'm right below it.
So we've had that covert box out on Junction Creek, but it's been more towards the school.
No, are you? Because Liberty School is tucked in there.
So we do a lot of, we want to check traffic and speeds through there at the school because it's an issue. In fact, I just convinced the city to extend the red zones over there so that the crossing guard gets a little bit more sight line because there are people coming through there not able to see the crossing guard with the kids in the crosswalk. So those are all things that we look at and we try and evaluate and say, can we do something quick to help with the problem that we've got? But that covert box has been on Junction Creek or Junction Street. It's just been closer to the school. So
when you say extend by the school, do you mean go north and south more? Or?
So where the crossing guard's at, you know, where the church is across the street.
Yeah.
So that crossing guard and that crosswalk just right there, there was a very short red zone there, and in the morning, parents would park up against the curb, let their kids
oh,
off.
Oh, I go, see what you're saying. Okay.
Yeah, go across the street right there. Well, that red zone was so short that people coming down Junction Creek couldn't see past all the cars parked.
Yeah.
And so it's just a big safety concern.
The kids were a quarter through the road before they could even see them.
Oh, wow.
So we extended that. We basically took a parking space away from parents who were upset. But we created a safety barrier for sight line for the kids in the crossing area to get across the street there.
Fantastic. So. And beyond that, is there anything else you'd tell me? Like, I'm always torn. Do I call you all? Do I drive you nuts? Are you sick of hearing me? Or does that help the record?
So, I'm going to give you my car.
Okay.
You can call me, you can text me, you can email me.
Oh, you're in trouble. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
And that's a great question, Rob. And I mean, it's because if we don't know, we don't know. You know, I mean, we can only be so many places. And, you know, but the city itself is about 17 and a half square miles. You know, we have 50-ish police officers and our support personnel. So we can't be everywhere at any given time. So we really rely upon our citizens to help us identify problem areas. You know, and some of the bigger issues, you know, but it just depends on who you talk to, what it is. An issue to you that's a big issue to you, you know, it may not necessarily rise up because the data is important to you, but it's a big issue to you, so take the time to call, we'll prioritize it, we'll make it important to us, and we'll get out there to rectify it.
Thank you.
I wholeheartedly feel your frustration. There's a stop sign right in front of my house that gets stopped at probably 1 out of every 100 cars.
Are you kidding?
It's bad.
But he's got a front.
Yeah. It's so, yeah, it's frustrating.
Your patrol car isn't parked in your driveway.
So, Robin, since it looks like we're going to have lots of time for stuff, I'd also like to throw out, Casey opened up talking about engineering. And to be honest, we would love to not have to enforce traffic laws because the roads are designed perfectly. Now, there is no perfect road out there, but there is an engineering component to it, and that curve has been a problem thing that I don't think the engineers even really fully know what to do with it. So enforcement and education are more, they really are kind of short-term stuff. We can modify behavior by writing tickets. We can put 5 cops up there for 2 weeks straight and write 1,000 tickets, and that'll have an impact for 2 or 3 months. And then as soon as they realize that the cops aren't there as much, you'll start seeing
So there is a partnership that we have to work with, and it makes it very challenging when it's right on that cusp of city and county and how this road needs to be engineered to kind of modify the driving behavior without having to bring into the enforcement component.
Police departments are only as good as our partnerships with the community. And I like what Jacob said, because that's true. And because crime goes up and down, it's in different places, and we can't be everywhere at once. And so we definitely need to be one with the community and understand where these things are occurring.
Well, is your partnership with the county part of this? Because one of the problems is they put a sign that makes it look like it's 35 when you come around the curve, and they won't. They've been asked for years to move it down, so people think by the time they see that sign it's 35, but they haven't even gotten to the city limit yet.
We can reach out to our streets superintendent and just ask about it again.
We ask about this stuff all the time in different places, so thank you.
What about if we got to paint on the streets, still 25? Still 25. No, I'm serious. Or I've even thought, what if the city could put big yellow 25-mile-per-hour stickers on everybody's trash can and recycle, so twice a week people go 25, 25, 25, and they're reminded when they go down the street. You know what I mean?
He's taking notes, so we can give Joey Medina and say,
you guys are like a dream come true for me. I should shut up. There are some people here, but thank you
so much. I've got a sign professional, and when I talk to the sign professionals at the city, they think, I'm like, let's put up lots of signs. There's such thing as sign pollution. And then people quit looking at signs after they're up a long time. So, but you know, just it's really a totality of everything that we do. And so we need to look at all these things that you discussed.
Somebody put a sign in my yard, it wasn't me, I got a lot of credit for it a few years ago, that it said suicidal deer. And it stayed for years and then it got stolen. But there are actually two places in there that the deer cross routinely that need, like, how would we get signs for slow for wildlife?
So he's kind of laughing about sign pollution too, but that also goes back to the engineers have the National Highway Transportation Safety recommendations, and they get into how many signs to put where, and that includes like the 35 mile an hour sign and where it should be placed on the roadway, and a lot of that's subjective and a bunch of mumbo jumbo and doesn't always apply to, you know, real world situation that you're looking at. So the deer crossing, I think that's, yeah, I mean, we can bring it up with, you know, when we reach out to the street superintendent.
I think roundabouts are about the answer to just about any problem that there is roundabouts.
You're right.
Because they confuse everybody and slow them down.
Slow them down between roundabouts just about.
Yeah.
Got five of those in my neighborhood. The Dodge Chargers and the Mustangs just go faster in between them. So, it's give or take. Yeah, it's really about attitude. Thank you, Rob. Yes?
I don't want to, if anybody else has a question. I have a question about a lot of attention has been on the fire department, but very little actually for our police department. And I know the shoebox that you live in. I am more than aware of the terrible situation as a former city councilor, what it looks like in the police department. And it makes me very sad as a citizen that it's still going on. So I am an advocate for moving the police department and moving it to 9R, I think that'd be a great idea. That's me. But I also wanted to ask about the impact of the parking. If the dominoes fall and you leave that little shoebox that you live in, how many parking spaces will be opened up from the removal of the police department if you go to 9R? So that might be information that would help.
Okay. Did you get that, Amy?
I did.
Okay. So what do we have out front for our designated spots? 20?
So I sent the architect
information a couple of weeks ago about how many spaces we actually need. Because right now what we do is...
How many do we have at the PD right now?
We've only got like 20...
I'll say 26, 28,
28 at that spot.
So on 2nd Avenue and on 10th Street, we have designated parking spots for police. And I think it's 26, 28, something like that, between the two spots right there. So we would give those spaces obviously back to the city. But those are just the ones that are designated for police and visitors right there. So every one of our officers or professional people that come to work every day, they have to park in the neighborhoods.
Right.
And so we have some meter parking that we do over on 9th Street. We have some in the city lots down off of 800 block of 2nd. So there's those spots there that would then be freed up as well. And then all of our officers typically park either on 10th, on 3rd, 4th, you know, somewhere 10th, 11th, you know, 9th to 12th. But I've had to park 5th Avenue and 12th Street before because there's no other parking. So we're parking in the neighborhoods there too. And we have a huge special event, Snowdown, where it's all hands on deck, 4th of July. We're looking at 70 spots total.
Easily.
Yeah,
how many?
About 70 probably.
Yes. That we're occupying.
To between our personal vehicles and our police cars.
If it's not a special event, how many do you need?
Any given time, you know, again, we've got those 20 some odd spots for the marked police cars or our patrol cars. And then we probably have, between our support personnel, between peak times, overlaps during the day, probably another 20, 25. Ish spots that are taken up throughout the neighborhood. So it's probably in the ballpark of 50 spots on any given day. And then on special event days, it's going to swell up from there.
So what you're saying is by moving the police department and all the personnel out of 2nd Avenue, the city could gain 50 spots, basically.
Yeah, between the CBD and, you know, out in the neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. I think that's really good information to share. Because that's an advantage. That's a plus for the redevelopment of the building on 2nd Avenue, as well as taking personal cars out of neighborhoods. And I mean, I live in a neighborhood where people park, you know, because they work close by. They park in front of my house. I'm used to it, but I think it would be a real, definitely I see it as an advantage of moving you somewhere else.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I'll just keep asking questions. Do you anticipate, if you were able to move somewhere else, to be able to increase the patrol numbers? I mean, I think you're so squeezed in, you really don't have room for more people. That's the way it appears. And obviously with the evidence, and you might address that, where all the evidence is stored, on-site and off-site as well. Would you anticipate increasing some patrol numbers?
Yes, absolutely. But the building's not going to be the dictating factor to that. It's just a matter of finding people to fill the ranks. We can do that now, and we'll continue to work in a craft space. But the building will, for sure. But yeah, the building right now, we don't have a single closet left in that facility. We just recently did another conversion of our last storage unit that was inside the building. So now we have a sergeant that works in an office, and he's got a ladder that goes up to the, outside the roof access. So it's a great place for him to hang his uniform. But you know, that was the last closet we had. So we had all the boxes and everything that were in there, we had to take out. Jacob has them stacked in his office. We've all got insured it, and so now we have just piles in the corner of our office with Christmas decorations or whatever the case may be. So we're completely out of space. Even at the substation out in Three Springs, we're completely out of space. Every one of those subsection offices out there are being utilized by someone. If it's the core team, if it's the traffic team, if it's the code enforcement's out there, and we use it as a training facility. And those are all extra spots out there too, and that's completely different. And so we've completely outgrown all capacity for growth when it comes to that. But you know, right now, I've got the blessing of the city manager, or if we can get to our staffing numbers that we're allocated for right now, we can exceed those. And then, then we'll go to council and ask for those appropriations to increase our budget if we need it. Or, right now we have salary savings, so we can carry those positions over based off of that. And then once the new budget cycle comes in, we'll just have those FTEs, full-time employees to that, and we'll just keep going.
Speaking of
but we're working in that capacity right now of what is our need. And you know, we're looking at a couple different models of staffing to determine what that is. But right now we think we're at least a full patrol team down. So that's, you know, we're between 10 and 12 people, you know, with the supervisor and the detective to office support and everything else.
So you have the money for more patrol, you just don't have interested parties.
Right. Well, we have people coming in still, but I mean, it's to put the this is a national problem. This is a national conversation. We're talking about staffing across this country, and this is one of the number one topics that chiefs and sheriffs continue to talk about. And it's challenging across the board. Essentially, even in Canada, we talk to our cohorts up there and places in Europe. It's a tough spot to be in. Our numbers per se, we used to get between 100 and 120 applicants in a year. This is probably 3 or 4 years ago. And we would hire probably 12. So about 10% on average of what we would hire. Now we're getting about 30 or 40 applicants every year. And we're still down to about that same 10 to 15% of finding, you know, after we go through the process, qualified people to fill our ranks.
Are your salaries high enough? Is that part of it?
That's a great question. So we pay pretty well here. We're not the highest paid department, but we're also, we need to, you know, make sure we're comparing around. We're not comparing against New York, LA, or
right.
Sacramento, you know, agencies that start off over $100,000 a year. For Western Slope, Colorado, we are competitive with them. But Grand Junction, Cortez, other agencies, or other areas, their cost of living is not as close to what ours is. So, in order for an officer to live in the city of Durango, we're not competitive at all. And that's where we lose officers too. You know, I just recently did an article in the paper, and we have 5 officers, 2 of them live up here, or up here, and live in New Mexico. We've got 3 officers that live in the city limits of Durango. One of those is me. So, I mean, that really puts it, I think, in the greatest perspective, because everybody else lives out in the county, or they live in New Mexico, or they live in Montezuma County. You know,
okay.
So they're living, and they continue to branch out and go further and further away, because the inventory and the cost of living in Durango continues to expand, because we continue to grow all the zones that go. So that's the real big challenge we've got right now with that. Are we competitive? Our benefits are fantastic. Our retirement is fantastic. Our pay scale is very comparative. To other organizations, but right now we don't necessarily have a mechanism to sort of progress our officers through that pay scale at a timely fashion enough in order for them to be successful to be able to invest in the community. And that's usually what we see those turnarounds in 3 to 5 year mark, where they're going to a place like Love, where they get $15,000 signing bonus, and then start off at $65,000-$70,000, and then housing costs is $450 instead of $670. So.
Well, that's tough.
Yeah. Well, I'm telling you, the officers we are getting are fantastic. And they're doing a great job. They're young, they're going with a whole lot of experience because they're new to the profession, but they're smart, they're learning quickly, and they are really doing our profession as a whole a real service, because of just what they're bringing was just different than maybe we brought as new officers when we came to the profession 20 years ago.
Most of them have degrees, they communicate effectively. We were talking about the other day, how do we know finding these people? I think a lot of it's the community, it's a destination community. It's one thing that maybe saves us a little bit, is people want to live here, people want to be around here, and a lot of people are involved in outdoor activities, sports, you know. You know, people that are involved in stuff like that are generally pretty active, and they come to work, and they want to make a difference, talk to people, build relationships with people. They make innovative changes in the office. We have brand new people making innovative software changes within the office that we're old, so maybe it's just innovative to us. But it's pretty impressive. I'm pretty humbled by the people that we're hiring. But yeah, we do have our challenges, absolutely.
A couple of months ago, I switched house alarm companies, and the new company didn't repair my alarm adequately for the switchover, and it went off at 11 at night. And the new company didn't have my right password, so they called, you know, the police on me. And those guys were there like, ah! I mean, I didn't have time to get out of my nightgown. And they were so nice to me, and they were so smart, and you know, I had to show them my ID that I lived there, but they handled it so well, and it was really helpful after. It was just, no pun intended, alarming to have that alarm go up in the middle of the night, and then to have the police call on me because this new company didn't know me, but those guys were wonderful and instantaneous.
Well, you know, and we always have to learn too. We will show up to calls and not handle them right sometimes, you know, because sometimes you get third-hand information to dispatch. And so the information they're even given was from somebody, was filtered before we get it. And so as officers, we really definitely try to train to show up and find out what's happening before we just show up and say, I'm here for a trespass. And then somebody's like, trespass? Why am I, you know what I mean? And you start this whole deal, you know, and then hopefully they're up, you know, they're we'll back off and say, well, no, let me see what I got. That's what, you know.
They did.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
What neighborhoods are generating the most service calls, or which neighborhoods are generating the most police reports that you have to fill out?
It's always the central business district.
Yeah, the bars?
Just the downtown area. There's a lot of trespassing, theft, and bar fights, and sexual assaults, and just the whole gamut of things downtown.
It's just the hub of the city.
Yeah, it's kind of that hub that we're always, that's why it's nice where we're located right now. Police department, because we're close to that, and we can respond pretty quickly to it. But that's always the hub of where things are at.
And the big box stores, we get a lot going on too.
Yeah, District 2 down south has been challenging. Purple Cliffs, we moved down there, that increased that. There's some relative, you know, challenges that we can point to.
Basically anywhere we have a largest population. I was in a hotspot class, it's called DDAC, several years ago, and they basically said that if you look at the center hotspot where your crime maps in any city of America, there will almost always be a Walmart at the center.
Is that true?
Yeah, probably. I'm sure there's some slight exaggeration there, but you gotta look at why. And the why is that's where the people are. So at any time, there's how many thousands of people probably at Walmart. And so when you get large groups of people together, car crashes happen, fights happen, whatever. So here, you know, it's going to be Walmart, it's going to be Central Business District. Hospitals always, you know, there's always, you know, a hot spot at a hospital as well, so things like that.
So just a little bit more. That's why the chief works often, he's a numbers guy, and he looks for hot spots, and he's always looking at different ways to run numbers and see what we have and answer that question, because I mean, if we don't know, how can we apply any strategy? How can we be innovative? People think just because this is a small town, you know, you just drive around or whatever, and that could be further from the case with the chief. And so one of the things that we also look at, innovation and strategy and software and all of that is absolutely key in our decision making and, you know, in our strategic planning and our budget. I mean, all that should go into budget. We should, you know, just look at a line item every year and see what we need the next year. Everything should be based around strategy. But at the same time, we need some common sense. And where there's all these people that Commander Malone's talking about in a large area, they need to lock their cars. So, you know, we can talk about all the strategy in the world, look at all the numbers in the world, but he's a big proponent also of pushing communication with our citizens. And again, like we talked about earlier, partnering with our citizens, because we're only a few. We're a community. We're not a police department. We're not citizens. We're a community. And if the problem is not locking your car, we have a ton of stolen cars. Just lock your doors. And so we're trying to get out right now. We're also using a lot of innovation, a lot of strategy, but also just some basic common sense.
I would add to that too, real quick, please, before you jump into that. But I think that's where law enforcement's failed in years past, is we've always cast this broad net upon our community without any specific strategy like Bryce is talking about. And if we can be a little bit more precise in our policing and focus our efforts on particular areas, particular problems, particular people, particular crime categories or something like that, really narrow it down, we can be efficient if we can actually make an impact on that. Because most of the crimes being committed in our community is not by 1,000 people, it's probably maybe about 100 people. So if we can focus our efforts on those particular areas at those times for those people and have the rest of our system work with us, and I'm talking about the criminal justice system with our jails and our prosecutors and our defense attorneys and even our defense attorneys and the judges, then I think we can be a little bit more strategic to actually deal with what those really core problems are. You know, and that's what we need to be strategic. And so it's called precision policing, precision prosecution, whatever it is, but we're a total system and we have to work together to do that. And that's where these things like Casey's talking about, you know, getting the data from traffic and hit a particular area at a particular time, or Walmart, you know, I'm looking at that, you know, I'm not just saying, okay, well, crimes being committed at Walmart. Okay, what kind of crimes being committed at Walmart? You know, is it theft? Probably. Okay, so how do we peel back that layer? Not just go off the symptoms of this, but actually what's the problem with it? And if we can eradicate the problem, we don't have symptoms, we don't have problems anymore. So that's kind of the overall general philosophy.
And a specific example of what he's talking about is like hotspot patrols. So Commander Malone talked about hotspots. And so we take the numbers and we'll pick a certain number of areas within the city and it changes strategically. But we have to be able to look at the data and see it because it's all about the result, right? But we're able to go to these areas and I'll rode along with an officer just to see how it was working. And what we do is we'll show up to these different hotspots randomly throughout the day. So you'll have everybody on a shift that goes and spends 10 minutes at each of these hotspots in between the calls and in between their proactive nature of looking for speeders and all the other things that they're doing. And they go to these hotspots randomly so people don't know when they're going to be there. And I was so proud when I was one of our newer officers. I actually rode to him and they park in on the sidewalk in front of Walmart in that big open area where they're real visual, or you'll see them downtown in that middle lane sometimes, just parked there for a long time. I love seeing that car there when I walk downtown. But they parked right in front of Walmart and we walked in and every employee called my officer by name and he's asking about their kids, hey, how'd that surgery go? And I was just sitting there, you know, I know pride's a bad thing, but I felt it, you know? And we went to every store and the same thing happened. And then he walked around back and there was some inebriants back there drinking and stuff, and he had a relationship with them too. And it was a positive relationship. And I was like, this is community policing. This is what it's about. They knew him by name. He knew them by name. He's like, hey, you guys need to move on. We know, you know, and did their thing or whatever and moved on to the next. And it was awesome.
Right on.
And I went back to my desk where I worried about paper cuts.
That's our true Durango. That's how it all used to be. Yeah. Everybody knew everybody's name. And I have one question.
Sure.
With all the illegals coming through, are you having to deal with that already? Or are you preparing for an onrush? Or are they wanting to go north and east?
Well, for one thing, we don't deal with immigration. It's a federal law, it's a federal system that deals with that.
Oh,
and
okay.
So we don't deal with immigration at all. So as people come into our community, we treat them as everybody else. You know, and that's one thing with Bulls Cup in Europe, so we've really tried to bond that relationship with them, that organization within the city, so they're an advocacy group for immigrants coming into the community, is we need to have that trust with them, regardless of the immigration status. We're really asking. Because that really has no state. It doesn't matter to us if they're here illegally or not. You know,
right.
If they're a victim, absolutely, that's an issue that we want to go do that. But we have to have that trust for them to come to us. Because many of their homeland countries, they don't have that trust in law enforcement because law enforcement is corrupt in other countries.
Right.
You know, so we want them to be able to come to us, report what it is. If you're a suspect, you're an immigrant, okay. You're going to be treated just like any other, you know, suspect or you know, offender within, you know, the bounds of our law. And then we take you to jail. They inquire about that immigration status, they pass the information on. So is it something we're concerned about? Not particularly, unless they're coming here to commit crimes, you know, and then we'll find out about that later, but it's not something we're going to look at on the front end.
Okay. I thought it would always be on the federals, but I wasn't sure.
Yep.
How that was, that was still holding or not.
I wanted to kind of back up just a little bit on Adam's question and kind of piggyback off some of the chief said and the deputy chief said. And, you know, I think it was in December, and you're going to have to help me out with numbers. What do you guys, if you remember, how many stolen cars we had?
The 42 last year.
Well, a month of December.
Numbers guy. Tell us.
We had 18 in December. So we had 18 stolen cars in the month of December. Do you remember the number of those that had the keys in them?
Mm-hmm. All did.
It was, if it wasn't 100%, it was 95%. And so that's frustrating. That's frustrating for us. That's frustrating for everybody. That's frustrating. You know, how do we fix that problem?
Adam, can you get that message out for us?
And so, you know, one of the things that we started doing and we're still continuing to do is we adopted it. It's called a lock it or lose it campaign. And just simple education, you know, handing out flyers to businesses, asking them to put them up, you know, we're gonna put stuff out on social media frequently, just reminding people, if you like your stuff, take care of it, you know what I mean? Don't leave it so someone can take it, because people will take it. And so, just, you know, stuff like that.
Yep, cars are an easy target, especially for teenagers and people going out in the middle of the night.
Most of the cars are being stolen. People are just walking around and they're just shaking door handles because they're looking to steal the contents out of the car. And then find the keys, they stick to the car. And then we pick it up again, you know. So, I mean, it's two crimes being committed by one, but we can eliminate both of those.
And oftentimes, they're using firearms in the car as well.
Yeah.
So we have to deal with that afterwards.
I think we only had five cars last year that we didn't recover. And most of them were local recoveries. So they aren't going far with them, they're just crimes of opportunity.
Right.
I thought it was illegal to leave your keys in the car.
It's illegal to leave your car running unattended unless you have like an auto store.
I have a comment and a suggestion. You used to write a column that I read in the Durango Herald, and I'm going to suggest that you write a column for the Durango Telegraph. And the reason is that the Telegraph is in every store, anywhere I go. People pick it up, read it, put it down, take it home. I'm not sure how many people read the Durango Herald anymore in terms of a paper. Many people read it online, but they don't
read. I love that online version.
Excuse me?
I said I love that online version.
Oh, not, well.
That was the that's how I heard about this meeting, you know.
Was it through social media?
The Herald.
Oh, the Herald.
It wasn't posted on the city's calendar.
Oh, I found out about it through next door. That's how I saw it.
Me too.
Somebody put it on next door. So I think the Telegraph is read a lot. So I
probably
would
is.
Suggest that you
it's a good
idea. Do that column in the Telegraph. Put the Herald too, I don't care. I mean, I read them both, but just to get that message out about locking your car.
That's a great idea.
You know, I mean, the more you communicate, the more you communicate. Even at Fort Lewis, they have their paper as well, and the Southern Youth Run as well. But I also would like to see you advocate the reverse 911.
Hey, what kind of calls are you getting at the hospitals that are actually inside the facilities?
Most of them are to assist the ER is the type of call we respond to the most at the hospital. They've got somebody that's on the ER.
So here's an interesting tidbit of information. So in order to dial out of the hospital from anywhere at the hospital, the first number you have to dial is 9. And which I don't know how that can even be a thing, because then someone gets 1 because they want to dial collect, and then they get 1 again, and immediately they get a 9.
Wow.
So that, and we have no idea what, because as soon as it gets called back, it goes to the main switchboard.
Main system.
So that's our most frequent call to the hospital.
That's our most frequent call to the hospital that we're trying to resolve. and it's a lot.
Oh, missed dials.
Yeah, it is a lot.
Okay.
And so
we've educated them to stay on the phone and tell us, and all their staff knows that, but the people that are there don't. You know.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's the number one call we get to the hospital.
Okay. What's your goal for the town hall meetings? This is the first one I've ever heard of it. Have you guys ever done one of these before?
Yeah, it's been a few years. Like Steph, I think it was probably 4 years ago, I think we did one, Chief Rapsall. And the goal of this one was community engagement. Have a conversation, let's talk, let's, you know, have that open dialogue. That's what we're looking for.
Ask the chief.
We're getting a lot of that.
Are we going to do a little speech or something first? And he says, no, I don't want to control the agenda. We're gonna sit there.
Right on.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
This is an opportunity for our community to talk to us. We do a lot of, you know, pushing information out through our social media platforms, through Herald or, you know, whatever else we do. So we do a lot of outward communication. This is really for the ones who wants to come in so that we can pay attention to it, see what's going on, see how we're connected.
Every book I read about communication talks a lot about listening. Maybe we can do more of that.
All right.
Okay, I'm gonna back up. The night of the Tercero fire, I got a reverse 911 and said, get out of your house. I got out 2 o'clock in the morning, it was awful. But the police were on the street, it was so good. We were fleeing, a bunch of neighbors came together at the fire. helped each other, and the police department was so fabulous. I get all emotional because it was a terrible night. It was a terrible night in my neighborhood. Fire department was there, police department was there, but it was the call I got that got me out of the house. And not everyone got that call. And so that's my point, that you had to sign up for it. I think it was code red on the city website.
So, sweetie, I can talk a little bit about that. The county emergency manager has been planning for a couple months now, and they're going to be having a countywide exercise for evacuating subdivisions for wildland fires. And one of the components of that is advocating for communities to get the word out, to sign up for that. Code Red is the system we're using right now, reverse 911. So there is some, now that's being driven by the county, because they're kind of spearheading, the county emergency managers
yes.
spearheading it, but we can work with our media, you know, City of Durango media, to make sure that we're getting the messaging out.
I'm an advocate for
it. What's that other one that we're using, the one that we just did for the cell phones?
That's the federal one.
We got Code Red.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember the name of it.
So there's a new system that we just implemented. Yeah, drop my car. But it's designed because most people have cell phones nowadays. They don't have a landline. So, and most people like in Durango come from other areas of the country. So they're not going to have an opportunity to sign up for this. So there's a new system that I can't remember.
You have to register.
But it's like an Amber Alert, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And so geographically, it's sent out based off your tower space. And it sends that message out, so you'll get this notification on your phone, on your cell phone, and it comes in as an emergency alert. Anyways, that's how that system works. So it's not something that you just have to, it's one of those little apps, or not apps, but just a feature in your phone that you just activate. And if you're in that geographical area where they activate this thing, you'll get the notification. So it's more broad, it's not specific as the reverse 911's career.
Well, we'll keep you updated on these meetings and stuff. We know you're real connected in the community, and we'll keep everybody connected this week as Commander Dunlop goes to that meeting and we move forward. Thank you.
So I would like to ask a question. I'm sure it doesn't have a good answer, but as in terms of your housing issue, do you think there's a way to work with the city or grants or anything to supplement homes? Is there anything we could advocate for you all so you can live here?
Yes, and so This has been a topic of city council as of late, where they want to have affordable workforce housing for police officers, firefighters, teachers, critical staff throughout the city. There's a bunch of different ways of doing that. We actually hired a, but she's our housing solutions person for the city. She actually came from Summit County. She works in the city. She came from Summit County. And Summit County's got a process up there, which is really cool. It's Keystone, Silverthorne, that area of the state, where there's part of sales tax goes along with that. I can't remember what percentage of sales tax is, but it goes into workforce housing.
Oh, cool.
Then they're deed restricted, and because I think the average house up there is $1.1 million, is what they're saying up there. So a little more than our $670,000 work group. But they have, I think they own 350 homes between all the municipalities in the county that is deed restricted and it has to get passed to another employee, maybe the
really?
City or county. So that's how they solved it. Aspen's done it, Vail's done it, Telluride's got, you know, some supplemental workforce barracks and stuff. So they're looking at the solutions, we just don't know necessarily what that model's gonna look like for Durango and how it's gonna fit.
So do you know, I mean, if it's deed restricted, does the owner of the house get a tax break or?
There's a whole bunch of different areas for that. So they don't necessarily know. I know it's Sub County, I mean the most, I think it's a 2,300 square foot, four bedroom, three bath home, and I think they cap it at $450,000. Yeah, and so, and that's like, you know, that's just how it gets transferred over to the next city employee or county employee. So there's still discussion amongst council because some council members have a different vision of what that looks like because, you know, housing equity is something that people like to try to build because that's one of the strongest areas of growth for any investment before them. That's how, you know, most people, you know, move from one place to another is because of real estate deals. And so if we deed restrict it, then the employee would never really actually benefit from the growth of that property. So how do we do that, but still be able to get people in the city to move here? So a lot of conversations going on with it, so.
And do you think your officers would go for that? They would like that?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think, you know, any opportunity, because they, a rental car. I mean, how many rental cars have you washed before you turned in? Or put premium fuel in before you topped it off? Probably have.
Right,
so it's
right,
kind of that
right.
Investment into something that you're on. It's kind of enough. And so, you know, I mean, if someone lives in a community, they work in that community, then, you know, I think they're going to potentially have a little more pride in the community as a whole. But we have such a great area here that where everybody, you know, and the whole of the community is a little bit more spread out. I think that we can still attain that as a whole, but, you know, how do we get it a little bit more condensed versus having somebody go to Cortez?
Do you know if that model that's being thrown around, or models, plural, involves a rent, like a landlord, a package either?
It's so up in the air right now, such in infancy. I don't know necessarily which direction they're going to go with it.
I would think that there are so many people that own rentals in Durango. If the new officer moved, he might want to live for a year in a rental while he found a place to live that he liked. If they could do something with the landlords, I think people would be open to it.
Potentially. I would encourage you to go talk to your city council because they're the ones that are driving that, and I'm sure they'll be open to any conversation.
I will.
Hey, Amy, did you find that 911 thing that the chief was talking about?
The what?
Did you find the 911?
I paused.
I paused? Okay, never mind. I thought she said you had found it. I'm
no,
sorry.
No, I raised my hand because I wanted to say something. Oh, wait, what I raised my hand?
Oh.
I think it's rapid SOS. That man.
Okay. Yeah, I think you hear it. Rapid SOS.
What's iPods?
Okay,
rarely do I bet against the chief on a good memory, but I'm going with you, Tom.
So I remember reading the Office of Emergency Management press release, and they're just bringing up code red.
Is that something people? We can sign up for?
Yeah.
Code red is, yeah.
It's just, you have to register where your number is, you know, what your number is and where you live, so that they actually plot it out on a map. So if they want to send out an evacuation order, it basically just draw where they want to evacuate on the map and say, send a message. So you do have to affiliate your phone number with a residence in that area to be able to get that. But yeah, it can be done through Code Red, and
there's obviously limitations, so we need to move on with technology, et cetera.
So they're saying it's through the county's website at, under the emergency management tab.
Hmm.
City might do it as well. This is all through dispatch, mm-hmm. which is a city, county, fire department.
Mm-hmm. It's very effective, I think, because of the Tercera fire, I found it was instant. And people who were on the street, they were the ones that received the Code Red. So it showed me that not many people had signed up. That's what it showed me.
Well, there's still a component of, you know, law enforcement going door to door in those situations too. That's just part of it, because technology is not going to fix everything.
Right.
So it'll help, you know, maybe get 80%, but then you still have the other 20% that you need to wake up and say, hey, there's stuff going on. We need to get you. So.
Amy. Absolutely right. The chief sends these out and thanks the officers and continues that culture. And we also have a culture of accountability where we receive complaints. And we look into every single complaint and contact the citizen that complained and make them part of the process as well. So while that's true, and we do have that culture, Amy, you're absolutely right. We also look into any negative comment we get, because we have several avenues that people can call in with any negative comment as well.
Do you guys still have some committee of people that reviews complaints outside of the police department?
Yes, we do. So we have the complaint review committee that comes in once a year, and my internal affairs sergeant has been here over 35 years, and so I love Dex Shaline. You guys know who he is. And he's amazing, because he looks at everything, relentlessly. And he's keen to the policy and procedures, case law, state law, good, and everything that we're supposed to do right, best practice. And he takes the middle of the road and looks at all the facts, looks at the video evidence and everything else, and he's able to put everything down in a report. And then we look at the report, and it goes through a chain of command, and every single person up here looks at it as it goes up. We give our 2 cents as it goes through. And I mean, you talk about experience. We went down the line, and you have most of us up here have had 20 plus years experience in this profession, and we look at it with a fine-tooth comb. And then it makes its way all the way to the chief, and we make recommendations. It may be a policy issue, it may be a training issue, it may be a disciplinary issue, and we make those determinations, and we create a culture of accountability where we're looking in the mirror, because as human beings, we want to look out the window, but that's not where we look if we're going to get better. And so at the end of the day, we meet with this committee, which are citizens, but we also want to be transcendent, right? Because our learning becomes incestual inside as police officers, and we think like police officers. And so it's good to have the community also look at it, and they look at all of our complaints at the end of the year in their entirety,
and they make any recommendations if they think that we performed a good investigation, or if an investigation could use some work, or if it needs to be seen through a different set of eyes.
That committee comprises 7 people this year, and there's also a member of the City Council who is a representative from the Community Relations Commission, but also sits on there for additional transparency. That's what we have in this last year.
Who's that?
Currently, it's the mayor, Barbara Roseworthy.
Okay. And then who are the other people on the committee? Yeah.
You want to run through? We got Erin Heider, who's our internal, but she's appointed by the city manager, so she's our internal cultural. Internal cultural services manager. So that's what she does with the city. So she's appointed by the city. We've got who else? We got
Dwayne.
Gil Harris.
Gil Harris. Dwayne.
Dwayne Perry. Dave Kearns from Fort Mills College, retired federal judge, Judge West is on there.
It's a super diverse group, a lot of background, a lot of history, mm-hmm. a lot of connection to the community. It's a really solid group.
If you get with me later, I'll be able to get you an entire list. I'm just trying to think off the top.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, we publish it every year
yeah.
when the paper does their story on it.
Mm-hmm.
I have another suggestion. I guess it was back in the 70s or 80s, and I'm trying to think of the officer's name. In my neighborhood, I live on the west side, we had a neighborhood organization at that time, and the neighbors came together, and an officer came to our meeting and gave us great ideas about how to protect our home better. And one of the best things I remember is he said, leave your front porch light on. And I've done that for 40 years. And so I'm sharing that I know you're stretched thin, but if you could finding key people in neighborhoods that would organize a neighborhood meeting and have somebody come out and give suggestions like speeding, you know, in the neighborhood, or how to protect your property. Don't leave your bicycle out in the front yard. Lock your cars, front porch lights on. Then you're in the neighborhood. You're going to where they are, and it would be me calling my neighbors to get them together to come over. And it's a friendlier. I mean, why aren't there more people here? That's my question. So I'm willing to do it. And I bet we could find other people in other neighborhoods that would help bring people together. And it brought the officer, and it was a really good event at my house, and he gave us great suggestions. So I'm just sharing with you because my lights are on for the last 40 some odd years because of what he said.
So at one point in my past, I was over a division that did neighborhood watch meetings, and the trend across the U.S., I mean, not necessarily know if it's a good trend, has been replacing traditional neighborhood watch with next door. And the agency's representatives join neighborhoods and they post on these next door. It's a whole lot more informal, and there's that non-human interaction, and I don't know if it's as good. However, you're reaching far more people. And you know, what's evidenced in this room of people attending is kind of what the trends were doing in neighborhood watches, at least in my experience, is they were dwindling and dwindling. Because everybody's so busy now and so reliant on social media. And so that was a long way to say, I don't know if it's better, probably not.
Does your department post anything to Nextdoor?
Do we? I don't know if we do Nextdoor.
No, there's some rules that govern around it, where we tried to get into it before, and so I think we can read it, but we can't engage in it. I think is how that works. That's why we have to go with our platforms like Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, those type of things, because you actually, there's some background rules to it, and again, I think, again, we can sign up to it to monitor, but we can't engage in it. So that's correct, right?
Yeah.
Works.
But Carol's looking into a lot of that right now and is trying to get more involved in Nextdoor as well. We actually had a meeting about it last
Thompson is right back here.
Oh, that's you. You post on Nextdoor.
They asked if we were involved in Nextdoor.
So I think the obstacle with Nextdoor is you have to be a member of that area, right? In order to post, so it's based on neighborhood, so, you know.
We'd be able to have around the police department.
So, but there's workarounds on that, correct, Tom?
Yeah, we, I post as an individual, but we have a city account also that allows us to post too. And I didn't set that one up. There was a green next door and a blue next door, and it was a few hurdles we had to.
So where did you post this?
So we had it posted two different places on the Durango Herald. At their community events, and then they have another area, I can't remember what it was called. We, I believe, requested to have it put on the city's
calendar.
I don't know, apparently that didn't happen, and then we posted it starting last Wednesday on our social media accounts, and then again today on our social media accounts.
Oh, right on.
You said you saw it on Nextdoor?
Some person.
I saw it on Nextdoor. You're some lady who runs your PR.
Carol. Okay, that was
it.
Carol's
was
thing.
Woman.
She put it on.
Yeah, she said she had to do it on her personal account,
yeah.
But she's trying to find out how we can get more involved.
Just at the last minute, I saw it.
Yeah.
I love Sweetie's idea about it. Colin, or you guys do trade on. Rotate, right? You should all write a column about your favorite pet peeve.
Yeah. No, that is a good idea.
Well, I got to tell you, I'm going on Nextdoor tomorrow and ragging on everybody, so I'm not being here.
All right.
Good for you. People should do more of that.
You'd probably like to leave early. We could give you that gift.
Well, yeah, we can close that. There's no more questions, and I really appreciate y'all making the time this evening. And maybe the one we do in the fall, but we are going to do a couple of them before we got three screens,
the bid to the CBD. We are Fort Lewis, we're going to do one.
Yeah.
And then the fourth one is.
No. Cool.
So we're gonna continue to try to broaden this out.
Yeah, I should have.
We'll see.
I looked.
Could I just say goodbye to each of you? I don't want to leave with this weird COVID things, but could I just
absolutely.
Come up and
thanks.
I hope to see you at a conference.
Hey,
I was
a yes, it's like a water current.
You and I missed you.
Cold water, sorry.
I'm just a detective, but I was here for special.
Yeah, you should.
Is that double as a gimbal?
This is a Benro. No, this is not a gimbal.
Okay.
It's just rigid. But this is a battery.
Oh.
External battery, because the battery for an iPhone is not going to last that long. You know?
How long is the battery?
I don't know. I haven't had
it. Oh, is it 53 minutes?
53%.
Oh, okay.
So I could probably go to like 2 hours or 3 hours. Yeah, it would last a while.
Yeah.
And then this thing is mainly just a lock. You know, it's really good for being a monopod. Just stabilize the the photo, you know?
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny because we have all the recess. Because it's like we can't.
Yeah, for sure. And I've been learning about how a lot of cameras, the batteries don't last that long. I've got a few cameras that just die pretty quickly. And if there's a benefit to being able to plug it in with a battery, an external battery, so that's what I found.
All right,
likewise, Tom.